Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all of you, no matter where you are. I'm Jingjing Lin. I'm currently presenting a conference paper that has been accepted to IEEE TAIL 2020 conference. So this year earlier, I was thinking, what's the status of e-learning implementation research in entrepreneurship education? So I wanted to take on a systematic literature review about it. And this is the result of that small project research in collaboration with Professor Tomoki Sakiguchi from Kyoto University. So 2 years ago, two US scholars, they surveyed 568 educators who teach entrepreneurship education in community colleges in the US. And they indicated that face-to-face instruction still dominates the delivery mode, while the online instruction delivery mode is comparatively low, hitting about 12%. They all expect that in 2 years, face-to-face instruction will decrease while the online instruction will increase. Here we are in 2020, 2 years later. We all know that due to coronavirus, 100% online class takes place globally. So this is such a dramatic change that nobody expected 2 years ago. But we are just not quite prepared for this, isn't it? It's like we only when encountering unexpected fire in the house, we then wish we had installed an extinguisher somewhere in the apartment. We treated e-learning more or less the same as the extinguisher in fire. If we look at the history of development of these two concepts, one is entrepreneurship education offerings worldwide and e-learning development. We see that since 1970s, US started offering widely entrepreneurship education programs. Until now, globally, everybody is talking about entrepreneurship education. E-learning happened much earlier, and it has gone through multiple stages. Now it's in the process of opening open and social distance education. And if you think that after half a century's development, entrepreneurship education must have been very well organized, synchronized with e-learning, you are probably looking at the wrong place. According to two studies that took place in UK and USA, and these two countries are most advanced, or the have the longest history of developing entrepreneurship education offerings, at least. From the surveying of 82 universities in UK and 270 community colleges in the US, it was found that not only the number of online delivery or hybrid structure instruction to teach entrepreneurship is comparatively lower than expected, but also the teaching methods adopted by lecturers tend to be very, very conventional. For instance, experiential, experience-based learning or action learning is considered quite effective as teaching entrepreneurship education, but less than 3% of the schools or teachers are using it in their classroom. So we have untrained lecturers, we have this group of educators, they prefer to teach via conventional lectures as seminars format. And now we needed to have them all online to teach students what will happen. It cannot work out that well, isn't it? And with this study, we actually need urgent updates in integrating e-learning in entrepreneurship education classrooms. And to do that, we need a better information from research to be more proof or evidence-based when we do some actions to promote this entrepreneurship education in our society. And to look into the literature, we found that there's no such a synthesis that exists to inform the further research or further actions. So we decided to do this as the first scientific attempt to charter the water. Our guiding research question is, what is the research status quo regarding the integration of e-learning in entrepreneurship education? We followed a five-step procedure to search for relevant literature and screen this literature for analysis. The first step, we actually compiled a list of 266 journals from both e-learning journals and entrepreneurship or management-related journals. The full list can be viewed by clicking the link that I provide here on the slides. The second step is we go to Scopus and only check all the publications published by these 266 journals. In the end, we found 105,079 articles published in only 183 journals out of 266. And then we just search in their titles, abstracts, and keywords, looking for the relevant literature using a list of preset keywords that you're going to see in the next slide. But let's move to the third step. After we found the relevant ones, only written in English, only articles, only review articles, we downloaded the output into a spreadsheet, and then we open the spreadsheet. Again, we use the preset keywords to look through the titles, abstracts, and keywords to exclude those irrelevant literature from the spreadsheet. Then afterwards, we move to the fifth step, which is eye screening, because using only the software to screen it is not fully accurate. So by adding eye screening, it can increase the accuracy of the literature to be included. And throughout this whole process, from step three to step five, you can see the retention rate of articles is quite dramatically different. So from step three to four, which is to screen in spreadsheet that was out was exported from the database, the retention rate is 40.8% relevant. And then after applying eye screening, the retention rate is 2.2%. So as you can see that many irrelevant literatures got excluded throughout this procedure. So these are the preset keywords, and these are the inclusion exclusion criteria. So we only consider one publication relevant when both aspects of entrepreneurship education and e-learning are present in titles or abstracts. Then we applied the three types of analysis into the literature. First, we ran some descriptive analytics to unveil and to unreal the temporal and spatial distribution of these publications and their impact in the academic community. Then we ran co-authorship analysis and citation analysis by source using the software Vault Viewer. In the end, we use 5W1H model to extract the semantic elements of each article. But in this paper, only 3W1H elements were reported, which covered who, what, where, and how. These methods have some methodological limitations. For instance, we use only broad terms like e-learning, entrepreneurship education, these kind of very broad terms in the search. And the second one is we use both viewer to analyze the bibliometric data, but our sample turned out to be rather small to reveal the full power of both viewer. And the third limitation is the result of using 5W1H model was actually not fully reported in this paper. And the fourth one is we didn't apply citation chaining to look for more relevant literature after we got the list of 41 articles. So we only rely on academic database. So some findings related to temporal distribution of the articles, we found the topic is very disappointingly, surprisingly under-researched over years from 2002 until 2020 May. The peak of the publication appeared around between 2018 and 2020, and the maximum number of publication year was in 2019 with a number of 11. So it's not that much produced over years. And they were distributed in different journals. In most cases, one journal in one in one independent one article in one independent journals is quite often seen for 24 articles out of 41. The most active journals are, for instance, Journal of Entrepreneurship Education. And there's a rather balanced distribution between business journals and e-learning journals, which is different from the finding of Abov, who did a review of literature published between 2000 and 2008 and found that business scholars tend to publish in business journals and avoid publishing and sharing in online education journals. A possible reasons for such improvement is because we add a 12-year-long new literature to the pool, and and there's actual improvement over one decade's development. The second reason can be the topic is has been very new to both communities, and it attracted from both sides pioneer researchers. But not many, very few authors, they are repeatedly publishing on the topic. In fact, only 8 authors, they publish two publications. All others publish only one. And co-authorship among all these 103 unique authors is quite rare. Only 2 groups collaborating with each other 2 times, resulting 4 papers in total. The possible reasons behind this is scholars only hold temporary research interests in this topic, or it is really an early stage research field, or there's a stressing continuity problem in the topic. European scholars are most active. USA and UK, despite the long history of offering entrepreneurship education, are not quite representative on the topic's research. And this is consistent with some previous studies striking that Western Europe have been tremendously developing in entrepreneurship education and conducting European research towards understanding better about entrepreneurship education. Well, the impact of these 41 articles, I'd say over 18 years development, the total citations number were 748, and the maximum citation was published, the max citation number was from an article published in 2014, and the citation number is 119. On average, every article received about 18 citation number. It is called somehow limited impact if we look at how what is a good number of citations for an article. So if you receive more than 10, so you are in the top 24 of the most cited, and if you are less, you receive less than 10, that's common scenario, and if you receive one or more, you are already in the top half. But for this 41 studies, we have like 7% received more than 100 times of citation, and 63% received more than 10, less than 10, and 36.6% received more than 10. So if you look at this kind of comparison, you feel it is kind of fine. But if you look at the H index, the 12 articles out of 41, they receive more than 12 citations. So that makes the H index of this whole group as 12, which is below 20. 20 is good, 40 is outstanding, 60 is truly exceptional. So 12 is less than good. So when we go to check what kind of contents are being studied, what kind of audience are being studied, we found the students are the most used audience to study the topic, and scholars were quite interested in four aspects of e-learning topics. One is education, one is learning issues, one is students, and one is usability. So for education, constantly appearing topics include gamification, social networking, e-mentoring, online assessment. And for learning issues, quite constantly, they study about MOOCs, entrepreneurial traits, social entrepreneurship, and they're quite attracted to understand more about students' learning performance, attitude, and perception of e-learning in entrepreneurship education. And usability aspects, web-based learning, online course, and learning analytics were quite covered in different papers. As I mentioned before, European scholars tend to be the most active. And 68% of all 41 studies, they use quantitative research, majorly using surveying approach. Well, less than 31% used qualitative research, preferably using case study. This is a little bit different from Blanker, a study by Blanker and his colleagues. They state that qualitative approach is actually more preferable in entrepreneurship education research. So to sum it up, this is a scientific attempt that try to tackle an urgent need to synthesize the current research development in the topic of e-learning entrepreneurship education. And we found some primary findings regarding the topic, which needs definitely further elaboration in a longer version of the article. And there's one methodological observation out of it, that is when doing systematic literature review, you have to include eye screening to ensure to increase the relevance and credibility of your research. And in the future research, it is recommended that subtopics, concepts under the broader concepts like e-learning and entrepreneurship education, they should be used. So more detailed sub-level keywords should be used to investigate further on the topic. And in this study, citation chaining was not used, but it should be used for further investigation to track relevant literature from these 41 articles. I hope it benefits your research. I hope it also explains in a summary what this paper is about. Thank you very much for your attention.